So we're looking at 17.2, and the title is Monohybrid Inheritance. Now, what does that even mean, monohybrid? Well, you know that mono means one. So all we're doing is we're looking at one gene crossed with one gene. Well, that's what we've also always done, even at GCSE. The reason why they're calling it monohybrid inheritance here is because when you get to 17.4, they start talking about dihybrid inheritance. But we'll worry about that later. So with monohybrid inheritance, what we're looking at is what kind of ratios will we get probably in our offspring. So let's take an example of, like they've used in the book, they've used green versus yellow pea pods. They never pick anything exciting, they always pick something dull and boring, and we're looking at peas. So let's say that green peas are going to be given the capital letter G, and yellow peas are going to be given the capital, the lowercase letter G. Now, clearly that tells you a lot of information already, because you know that this is dominant and that this is recessive. And we always choose a letter that's different for its uppercase compared to its lowercase. Sometimes in exam questions, you're asked to choose the letter yourself. Never choose a letter like an S or a C, because you'll get yourself in a right muddle, because the uppercase and the lowercase of these letters are exactly the same. So we want to stay away from that. So if we're now looking at certain crosses, what happens if I cross a homozygous dominant with a homozygous recessive? Okay, so in other words, a pure breed green plant is going to give me GG, and the yellow is going to give me small g, small g. Well, I know from those that the gametes, all they can ever make is a G or a G. Now, to show that these are the actual gametes, what I need to do is put a circle around them. And the same for these. All it can give me is a small g or a small g. So when I cross those, I'm going to use this thing called a Punnett square. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show that these are the gametes. And the gametes are going to be down here as well. And what I'm going to then do is show the gametes by saying big G in a circle. And then small g in a circle. That's a bit of a rubbish diagram, but you get the idea. So now when we cross them, the likelihood, the probability, is that you're going to get one big G, little g. One big G, little g. One big G, little g. And one big G, little g. So all of the offspring are going to have green peas. There will be 100%. There will, because there's no other way they can combine. There will not be any yellow peas. Now, this is a way to find out if you've got a green pea plant, how do you know whether it's big G, whether its genome types are pure breed, or how do you know if it's big G, little big G? Because both of those are going to give you green peas. So how do you know? How you find out is when you breed them. You would take this plant and you would breed it with a pure breed yellow. And if all of your offspring were green, you know you had a pure breed. Let's have a look what happens if we don't have a pure breed. How will we know from the offspring? Well, what I'm going to do on this is I'm just going to change it. So this one would now be small g. This one would remain the same. So now what I would get is small g, and here I'd have small g. So if I had a green pea plant and I wanted to know, is it a pure breed? If I breed it with a yellow pea plant and all of the offspring are green, I know it was. But if 50% of my offspring are yellow, then I know that I started with a heterozygous pea plant. I'll now talk about a heterozygous cross with another heterozygous. So again, let's stick with the same letters. I've got a pea plant and it's green, but its genotype is big G, little G. And I've got another pea plant that's green and it's big G, little G. Well, what are the gametes that can be formed? I can have one of these or one of these, and with this one, I can have one of these and one of these. So again, I've circled them to show them to the examiner that they are gametes. And then when I put them into my Punnett square, I'm going to say gametes. I'm going to say gametes going down this way. See if I can do a better diagram this time. Spread it out a bit. I'm going to have big G, little G. I'm going to have big G and little G. And then I am going to cross them. So let's have a look. Big G, big G. Big G, little G. Little G, big G. Don't know why we always stick the capital first. You'd still get it right, but it's just convention. And then on the last one, so therefore we know that if you have heterozygous versus heterozygous, you're gonna get roughly 25% of your offspring that are gonna be homozygous recessive. So how does that help us? Well, if you imagine a farmer, he's been sold some seeds from some dodgy supplier somewhere, he wants to check them out, make sure that they all are pure breed. If he sows them, and he gets, because the numbers are never exact, if he gets something like 321 green and he gets 107 yellow, then those numbers are going to suggest to him that 75% of his offspring are this form, and roughly 25% of the total number are this form. So just seeing those numbers, 75 to 25, or 3 to 1, whichever way you want to word it, is recessive, then he can pretty much know that the two plants he breeded were both heterozygous. What they do is they then use, when they know what they've definitely got, they then use those for further genetic experiments. And so what we label these as is the first generation, the F1 generation. It's called the filial generation, but we can just refer to it as the F1 generation.